So I have a recent video or two talking about the Pleistocene megafauna, big, large mammals like the woolly mammoth, the woolly rhino, the giant ground sloth, and all of those things. But in today's video, I want to talk about the possibility of bringing these animals back from extinction. And specifically, whether we should do this or not. So that is, I think, one of the biggest questions that pops up when we talk about this de-extinction possibility. In other words, bringing animals back from extinction is whether we should do that. I think that question just comes from, you know, stereotypical things like Jurassic Park, Jurassic World, and this idea that we're just gonna screw it up, you know, as humans do. But there are some major benefits that I want to talk about in this video. And so let's get started by first just introducing this concept of de-extinction and how it might be possible. So because entire specimens of woolly mammoths have been found encased in Arctic permafrost and ice, we can sequence the genome of the woolly mammoth and gestate a cloned fetus in a modern elephant. In other words, to my understanding, it's kind of like the fetus itself will be genetically identical, more or less, to the woolly mammoth. It's not like we have just fragments of the DNA and we're filling in the rest with modern elephants. We have the entire genome, to my understanding, or at least most of it. So what we're making is making a genetic kind of clone to a woolly mammoth. However, there's like a surrogate mom that is the modern elephant, and that will be birthing the mammoth that is genetically a woolly mammoth. I, you know, could be explaining that horribly, but in any case, it's similar to Jurassic Park and World, and how they explained that with the dinosaurs. It's just less of the fragmented DNA filling in with modern species, and more so just taking the whole genome and just gestating it in a modern animal. That said, I do want to also just take this moment to point out, I know there's going to be comments asking this, but no, we can't do this with dinosaurs. There might be people that know better than me, but I think essentially anything past like a few thousand years, especially past a million years, is, you know, too far back for us to get any usable genetic material from, really, at least in terms of like a whole genome or most of a genome. So no, we can't go back 60 plus million years to when the dinosaurs roamed and get any real usable, you know, replicatable DNA from that time. It's just not gonna happen. DNA does not get preserved in rocks like bones do. Organic material wears away really quickly. So when we have things, especially things from an ice age, that one, are very young in geologic time at least, that is thousands rather than millions of years old, and two, you know, were living in an ice age when they could literally get frozen and preserved that way. Those two things really helped us out in terms of preservation of genetic material. But why do we want to bring back mammoths? And what other animals might we bring back and why? So we'll start with mammoths, and yes, there are both potential benefits and potential consequences to bringing back things like woolly mammoths, but let's start with the benefits. The benefits include things like improving environmental and ecosystem health, as well as combating climate change. But how does this actually work? How do they combat climate change? How do they improve ecosystem health and diversity and animal density in certain regions? Well, during the Pleistocene Ice Age, from about 2.6 million years ago until about 11,700 years ago, productive grassland grazing ecosystems were very common and widespread. These types of ecosystems, which are now only found in a few places in Africa, like the Serengeti, were on every continent. So let me just go back to this map really quick. This is a map showing the last glacial maximum vegetation, or distribution of vegetation on the globe during the last glacial maximum. The last glacial maximum just refers to the last time that ice extended, you know, southward because of a cooling. And this wasn't necessarily an ice age. It was just a glacial cycle of our current ice age or the Pleistocene ice age, because the Pleistocene ice age is marked by interglacial cycles that go up and down. You have cooling and warming, which leads to glacial expanse and glacial retreat. This was the last time that glaciers expanded due to a cooling cycle. And so in this last glacial maximum, which was around 25,000 to 15,000 years ago, we see that there are, in the red circles that I've pointed out, there are a lot of grassland type environments, grazing type environments. We have the one over here in North America is the temperate steppe grassland. Whenever it says steppe, S-T-E-P-P-E, or mammoth steppe, that refers to a type of grassland or ecosystem essentially where mammoths and other megafauna were trampling down the trees and kind of maintaining this open ecosystem where grazers could maintain the grasslands. And so that's what that means. You also then had tropical, tundra, and temperate grasslands in a lot of places. Pretty much anywhere there wasn't ice, you had some sort of grassland ecosystem somewhere. And one example of the hugely widespread mammoth steppe environment was one that spanned from the Arctic islands to China. And in this region, you had millions of mammoths, bison, horses, reindeer, wolves, large cats like the saber-toothed tiger, which wasn't a tiger, it was a large cat, but anyway, and all these other megafauna, which again, like I mentioned, maintained these grassland ecosystems. And as the Pleistocene Ice Age came to an end, mammoths and other megafauna began to decline and eventually went extinct due to multiple factors, including human activities like overhunting, land use, habitat destruction, and habitat fragmentation, newly introduced species and diseases, as well as invasive species, and you had Younger Dryas climate change. There was a rapid cooling event, well, a warming event, and then a rapid cooling event, kind of up and down spike right around this time that also contributed to their decline due to environmental changes and them having to move into regions or becoming limited in their range and then having to move into regions where obviously humans were either already moved into or coming to at the time, and that led to more overhunting, etc. So a combination of climate change and human activities led to the extinction of most of the megafauna around this time. And because without the help of these large animals, the grasses and herbs could not compete with the slower growing mosses, shrubs, and trees, this meant that the extinction of megafauna led to an accumulation of hay and litter and slow nutrient turnover, which led to the more low productive vegetation like mosses, shrubs, and trees, which took over. In other words, millions of square kilometers of high productive grasslands with fertile soils disappeared. Due to this transition and due to the lack of animal diversity and density that this new type of ecosystem can maintain, the Arctic animal density is now about 100 times lower than it was during the Pleistocene. There are, however, plans to revive the mammoth steppe grassland ecosystems and their mammoth populations. One park in Siberia has actually already begun this process. They're called Pleistocene Park, believe it or not. Essentially, they're introducing large herbivores back into the Arctic and maintaining their existence so that those herbivores can revive and then maintain the grassland ecosystems that once were widespread there. For now, they're just using modern large herbivores like bison, reindeer, horses, ox, and other typically ungulates that are large and grazing animals. But if we can and we do reintroduce mammoths, they would help greatly in restoring the grassland ecosystems by, one, trampling trees and shrubs and maintaining open habitats. But these ecosystems, or the restoration of these grassland mammoth steppe ecosystems, won't just increase animal density. They'll also help combat climate change in a variety of different ways. One, these grasslands cool the ground more efficiently than forests with no grazers, which means that this would prevent rapid permafrost melting. we know currently there is permafrost or frozen soil that is rapidly melting in Arctic regions, releasing a lot of trapped carbon compounds like CO2 and methane into the atmosphere. And in the winter, soil and permafrost are protected from the cool Arctic air by a layer of snow. So actually, this layer of snow protects and kind of insulates the soil below, or the permafrost layer below, and actually keeps it warmer than if that snow would be trampled down and away by grazers, leading to more cool, more frozen, non-melting permafrost, which is really huge. So essentially, the roaming of grazers in these regions would allow for deeper freezing permafrost, and obviously less permafrost melting, less carbon emissions, etc. These grasslands would not only store more carbon and release less due to deeper freezing permafrost, but also sequester more carbon and store it more efficiently than forests in these regions. This is because grasslands form deep root systems, storing the carbon they sequester from the atmosphere in the cold Arctic soils. I talk about how much better soil is at sequestering and storing carbon in a couple of my carbon sequestration videos. I'll link the most recent up here to the right for you. But essentially, the soil beneath the grasslands would store the organic carbon that is brought into it by the grassroots more long-term and efficiently than a forest land, especially with no grazers, which grazers being there in the grassland, grazing on the grass, leading to constant regrowth of that grass, leads to more constant carbon sequestration. These grasslands would also sequester carbon more year-round than forest and shrublands because the grazers keep more of the ground surface or the grass surface exposed during the winter, leading to more carbon sequestration year-round compared to the complete snow cover of the non-grassland, non-grazing ecosystem. Lastly, the surface color of grasslands is lighter than that of shrublands and forests. Essentially, this is a very simple concept called albedo. Lighter surfaces reflect more sunlight than darker surfaces. Darker surfaces absorb more sunlight than lighter surfaces. Lighter surfaces are cooler than darker ones, and so grasslands are typically slightly cooler than forests and shrublands. And again, cooler surface means less permafrost melting as well. But all of this stuff is about the mammoth steppe environment or grassland ecosystems rather than the mammoths themselves. So let's talk about who is bringing back the mammoths and when is this happening? Well, the biggest player in de-extinction technology right now is Colossal Laboratories and Biosciences, which have labs in the US and Australia. They plan to bring back the woolly mammoth, the dodo bird, and the Tasmanian tiger. And they claim that merging the biodiversity of the past with the innovations of the present can create a more sustainable future. They also state that mammoths will help restore elephant populations as well, which have also greatly declined in recent years. So when is this all happening? Well, Colossal hopes to have the first woolly mammoth on the way by 2027 and born by 2028, essentially gestating the first one starting in 2027, the gestation period is 22 months, and having it born in 2028 if all goes well. But are they right about bringing back extinct species? Will this help us build a more sustainable future? Or are there some consequences that should stop us from doing this? Well, the major consequences are things like introducing extinct species into modern ecosystems can disrupt existing food webs and ecological balances, so that would need to be taken into account. And adaptation to current climatic conditions and human-modified landscapes could be challenging for the species that are becoming de-extinct. However, like I refer to at the beginning of the video, Jurassic Park is typically where people's minds go when it comes to things like Pleistocene Park. However, initiatives like Pleistocene Park and another one called Rewilding Europe are conservation efforts. They are not theme parks. They are not attractions. So if we can account for things like how the food web is going to be affected and how we can maintain the existence of the species that we're de-extincting before we actually de-extinct them, then the benefits, at least based on what I've read, far outweigh the concerns. We're already seeing major positive impacts from the conservation efforts of Pleistocene Park and rewilding Europe, which aren't even bringing back extinct species yet. They're just introducing modern large herbivores into environments in order to restore lost ecosystems. And yeah, one day, maybe even as soon as 2028, we could reintroduce extinct species like the woolly mammoth into parks like these, which could help us build a much more sustainable future. And these parks and conservation initiatives are in large part driven by donations. So if you want to help out the cause or just go read more about them, I highly encourage you to go check out their websites, which are all linked down below. They have merch you can get, and they also have places you can donate or just places you can read more about what species they're implementing in different parks and regions, why and how they're helping with the conservation as well as ecosystem conservation and environmental conservation, not just conservation of the species, but also these ecosystems and grassland grazing environments. With that, I hope you guys enjoyed this video learning more about how we might bring back woolly mammoths and other extinct fauna and why that might be beneficial for us. And I'll see you guys in my next one. Bye.